A home of your own in Milton Keynes.
You've got French windows out as well into the back garden, which in this one's quite large. And you have a storage place outside for your lawn mowers and whatever else you need.
That's a nice sized garden.
Yes.
A new way of life in Milton Keynes.
The corporation give a tree voucher to all new tenants when they move in, all right? Mm. It's worth £3.50. You take it along to any of the garden centres that are listed. It's worth £3.50 to you. We give a list of trees suitable for the size of garden that you've got. All right.
And suppose we wanted two, do we get another voucher?
No, you don't. I'm afraid it's one voucher per house.
New job, new home, new life in Milton Keynes.
I am a writer and teacher, and I'm especially interested in the relationship between people and places. How do places affect the lives and chances of the people who live there? Cities, towns, suburbs and villages, and new towns, how do they help or hinder us? Do they give people the opportunity for an ampler, richer life, or do they simply allow people to do their own thing? That's why I'm standing here in what will be the centre of the new city of Milton Keynes. It'll be one of the biggest shopping centres, I'm told, in Europe. I think the new towns are the one positive achievement of British planning since the war. They're a national investment that actually shows a profit. For all their faults, they're the envy of almost every other country in the world. At home, they're often denigrated in spite of their virtues. Since the war, Britain has built or begun 32 new towns. People lump them together, but they're really all different, with different kinds of successes and different kinds of failures. The one that pushes the new town idea to its ultimate limits is the new city of Milton Keynes. It's the Muhammad Ali of the new towns, brash and possibly overconfident in its claims for its own future. But I wouldn't be surprised if these claims turn out to come true. Another of the myths about the new towns has been the idea that they've absurdly low densities, too much land for too few people, and have consumed precious land more extravagantly than other forms of development. In fact, the opposite is true, and I think myself that the actual housing density in many new towns is too high. Milton Keynes is in Buckinghamshire, 40 miles from London, and it was planned to expand the existing population of 40,000 in the existing towns and villages, Bletchley, Stony Stratford and Wolverton, to an eventual 250,000. The government recently cut this figure back to 200,000, but it's still a formidable figure. There's no doubt it's all going to happen, however unlikely it seems today in a stagnant economy, for the most striking thing about Milton Keynes is its buoyancy. I see it as a city of hope. It was planned in the days when everyone assumed an infinitely growing economy. I think the planners assumed that every single citizen would have a car. There's a grid of roads in kilometre squares, and they get filled in patchily here and there like a child's colouring book. The early new towns have turned out to be an economic asset for the nation. Milton Keynes is the most ambitious, most expensive application of the new town idea. It calls itself the first new city. It's got everything going for it, from Coca-Cola and Volkswagen to the Open University. There's even talk of having the Olympic Games before long. Here's a local landmark made by local people. Visiting journalists usually make Bean Hill the focus of adverse criticism. It's a mass production housing job by a prestige firm of architects, Foster Associates, and from the outside, I don't like it much. But inside, I found these houses spacious and comfortable. Netherfield, too, has that uniformity which most people find hard to take about modern architecture. But what's it like to live there, especially if you've come from a rundown flat in London?
It's not too bad amenities-wise, but housing I don't like.
Because?
Well, it's cold. It's very hard to heat with it being three floors. So it works out expensive that way. But during the summer, it's nice. But yesterday, you don't get the sun in this room, so it's not too hot.
Just for the looks of it, which bit of Milton Keynes do you like best?
Eaglestone. It's nice houses and there's plenty of open space. There'll be somewhere for him to play.
And you've got radiators, which I like, because they're easier to dry clothes on, besides putting it out in the garden. So they're a lot better off up there. Even though it's further to go to the shops, because all they've got up there is one tiny little corner shop. But that is a bit expensive, but it gets you odds and ends if you need any.
What are your chances of moving over there?
To Eaglestone, near enough nil, because from what we can gather, it's a 5-year waiting list to move to Eaglestone.
In Eaglestone, the rents are a little higher. The architect here was Ralph Erskine, who's worked mainly in Sweden, but who built the famous Biker Wall in Newcastle. It's informal, friendly, domestic in scale, with careful provision for small children. It embodies most people's ideal image of home, a castle on the ground. It isn't just young people who move to Milton Keynes. George Blake and his wife came to join their son, whose firm, Telephone Rentals, has moved here. For their grandchildren from London, it's a holiday in the country.
All my life I've been going out fishing. I like the open country, wherever it is. And this is the nearest thing to the open country that I could see we'd ever get, you know. And so of course, I love it.
What do you see as the future of Milton Keynes?
Well, from what I see of what they're trying to do, as I say, I only hope that I'll live to see it.
The house itself and the surroundings are really marvellous. I do not wish to go back to London at all. It was so lovely to walk in from room to room and not be crowded in into one little space. I have every convenience here, a lovely bathroom, two toilets, which I never had in Fulham. I used to have to go to Fulham Baths to have a bath because the bath was so bad in London.
The Blakes live on Fishermead, not as popular as Eaglestone perhaps, but not as dispiriting as Netherfield. It isn't yet finished, but the signs are that it's working out fine. Mal Booth is one of the 13 arrivals workers employed by the Development Corporation. Her job is to visit people when they've just arrived and to go back a few months later to see how they're settling in. She's on a second visit now. Do some people just feel lost and lonely?
Yes, I think it's a very unusual family who can move from an environment that perhaps they've been in all their lives and come to somewhere like Milton Keynes, which is so different for them, and settle. It's much easier for us if people do this, of course, but they don't. And yes, I think it hits a lot of the families where the husband's out to work. The mother has young children and she's moved away from mum, who she either went around and had a coffee with or did her shopping with. And of course, mum could babysit. She now finds herself in a situation where this is all foreign. And that is why I think it's important for us to be available to help the people to set up groups, such as Coffee Morning and Mums and Todd's play group and that sort of thing, which we hope fills that gap for them.
Any other problems that you've had to report at all?
We had trouble with our the time switch upstairs.
On the central heating?
On the central heating, wasn't working.
Oh dear.
And we phoned them up and they said, yeah, we'll send someone down. 3 weeks later, they sent down a plumber. He looked at it, he said, don't need me, you need, who was it he said?
He said you need an electrician on it. So they got the electrician to come down and have a look. And after he left, we found a couple of days that the thing wasn't working.
Oh, it was a faulty one.
When I had a look myself, I just happened to look between the machine and found that a wire was on. So rather than call them out, I put it on and the thing's been going ever since.
Oh, that's good.
Stantonbury Campus is a vast secondary school and leisure centre planned from the start to provide recreation facilities for everyone.
Very nice run, Flutes, but it's all getting terribly kind of soggy, as if you've all eaten far too much suet pudding. I want some bounciness, I want some accents on the first and third beat, and notice what mark is written over your third beat. Do we not see a dot there?
Milton Keynes grows every day, and 20 new pupils a week start here. And the atmosphere is welcoming and informal. It's not just residents of the new city who use the sports centre, it's for the whole of North Buckinghamshire. In their greatest days before their decline, our giant cities, London, Liverpool or Glasgow, were a byword for squalor, overcrowding, appalling infant mortality rates. In their decline, thousands of millions have been spent on them, but they've usually been spent disastrously, leaving more liabilities than assets, while the much smaller sum poured into the new towns is already providing a handsome return to the Treasury. The critics have it both ways, of course, for if you point out that the new towns have absorbed only a small proportion of the enormous outward movement from the cities, only 13% of the outward movement from London, then they say that the new towns have become irrelevant. They then accuse the new towns of stealing jobs from the cities. But if you look at Milton Keynes, you find that it's provided 22,000 jobs, of which under a tenth were from firms moving from London, while half its new population came from there. One of the commonest criticisms of the new towns is that they do too much for people. And I agree absolutely with critics who can't stand the idea of a town where everything's done for people and they can't do anything for themselves. But the new towns have a better record than old local authorities in assisting self-build housing groups. At Milton Keynes, the Development Corporation has actively helped a housing cooperative to take over this old railway housing. People can pursue their private dreams in the new town. Chris Atkinson's passion is to stock the lakes and ponds of Milton Keynes with geese and ducks for the people of the city. And Don Ritson, the assistant general manager there, is striving to get legal approval for a sector of the city where people can come and do their own thing, push up their own shack and earn a living as a craftsman or market gardener. If you point out that the new towns have provided jobs and homes for large numbers of working class people who would not be enabled to get a more ample life outside the city in the way that richer people take for granted, then the critics reply that the new towns have done nothing for the really underprivileged or deprived. I don't agree, but, well, what have the old towns and the old cities done for them? From the evidence we've seen, we ought to reflect on whether ordinary people's aspirations for an ampler, more spacious life are better met in the old cities, their miles of suburbs, or the commuter villages for the affluent only, or in the new towns, which have at least tried to realise Howard's hope of giving the inhabitants the advantage of both city and country living.